will try and see how to use load pool with nonlinear, but also linear models, which is what the main Steve Cripps work is. And then there will be a design approach, which between me and Peter Abreu, we decided to call maximum efficiency line approach. First, we'll look at some previous designs approaches which were presented here using simulated load pool for fundamental and the second and first harmonic. And from there on, it moves to load pool, again simulated with predefined harmonic impedances. Then we move to way to have load pool contours without linear model, nonlinear model, which is the original Steve Cripps method, but improved by Peter Abreu's power parameters. And then we come finally to this design approach where we use linear model only for load pool contours. And again, the harmonics are defined and the matching networks are done by real frequency matching network synthesis. So this, the first design that I'm showing here, there were multiple load pool simulations done in microwave office for the fundamental second and third harmonic frequencies. It was synthesized, the matching networks, by the amplifier design wizard, which is a development of Peter Abreu. This is how it looks. It's an amplifier 2.2 to 2.8 gigahertz with the 25 watt Cree, wall speed, sorry, device. Results which are close between simulations and measurements. What is important is here, the transistor model was a black box, which means you cannot go inside and see the voltage and currents across the intrinsic generator. And that, by necessity, requires multiple loops, fundamental, second, third, and back and forth until we believe that you have extracted something that is best. And it's a time consuming. But this is how it was done. Over here, whoops, we have fundamental power and efficiency contours. And the final, but the finally decided one. And these are second and third harmonic load pools with this in the center of this circle was the fundamental when these were done, but again, multiple loops of going around. And the final selection of sections of second and third harmonic and the circle around was introduced to the matching network synthesis tool, and the amplifier was produced, and you saw what it looks like. In the next design, which was again reported in one of these forums, and maybe there was a paper about it, now we're using tri-quint Corvo transistor nowadays. The modelytics model now this time allows to look at the intrinsic voltages and currents. There is the inside of the model. Here we measure the current. Here we measure the voltage across the really intrinsic drain. All the parasitics are here. This is just the stripped active model. So now the load pool, as in the previous one, by the way, the tuner here can do fundamental second and third harmonic. The input was first kind of made stable, and there is a input tuner to match for particular frequency that we work on the output. And this was in the middle of, I think, 2.5, 2.4 gigahertz. The three frequencies, fundamental, second, and third, were pre-tuned for class F, which means the second harmonic is short, third is near open. Uh, And these are at the intrinsic point here. They are not on the outside. So we have the second and the third pre-tuned and the intrinsic generator, and this is the optimum at the generator impedance to give you maximum power. Just tuned, no load pull yet. So with this done, load pull, the second and third are predefined for class F. Now we do power, which is the blue one, and efficiency. And the green circle is where we're gonna target later for synthesis of the fundamental. With the fundamental in the middle of this circle, a second harmonic, and the third one is all open. The second harmonic is done across the Smith chart, and then the other one for the third. Here you see for the second harmonic what happens, and the whole this area is selected. The blue and the red for efficiency and for power. And because we have the pre-tuning of the harmonics, we don't need multiple loops now. Just one fundamental, 1 second, one third, done in half an hour. Finished, the data is there for a frequency. A few more frequencies and we go for the bandwidth. Actually, this was 2 gigahertz, now I remembered. what I was showing you. So amplifier was built, this data extracted for 1.8 to 2.2 gigahertz the way I showed you, for each, for a few frequencies every 100 megahertz, or maybe just three of them. Amplifier matching network synthesized in the amplifier design wizard. Simulations come again quite close to predictions, to measurements. And so what follows from here is to investigate this idea of predefined harmonic tuning, how we can go further, what it gives us further as a design approach. So now we're going back to the first transistor, but this time Wolfspeed already provides a model where we can measure the voltage and current at the intrinsic generator. And so we can also tune at the intrinsic generator. And I did it for class B, class F, and inverse class F. And if we go further, here is what starts happening. We are doing load pulls at 5 dB compression. And these are the power contours for class B. Blue, the green is F, and red is inverted class F. And the impedances are here for in each case for the fundamental. And what happens is there are these publications for continuous modes, and they come up with some equations here that if this is the optimum at class B for maximum power, for class F maximum power has to be multiplied by this number for inverted class F for this number, and the load pull came nearly on top of them. So now the mathematics here is for sort of pre-clipped situations, not in deep compression, but it works. Although I'm in 5 dB compression, it comes on top. So this develops into further ideas. Just in between also the efficiency contours were simulated, and you can see them here. And now they are together with the power contours. And what this tells us, there is a very broad area where you can have an amplifier, depends what you're looking for. And it's all kind of, you know, one is defined by the harmonics also, not just the fundamental. So the fundamental will fall where the harmonics are guiding it in some way. So if we look further at this, just to stretch the whole story, there are two additional contours with the thick lines where for class B was it or something, I put the harmonic impedances widely out, either at minus 90 both of them degrees or at plus 90. And what it tells you that the area that you can have good power, like here you can see the same power as previously, in both sides can stretch very wide. It depends where the harmonic impedances are. So what all this tells us is that if you're not careful with the, if you don't know where the harmonic impedance is, you could be in trouble. Your efficiency can drop 10%. Power could drop a dB or two. And I just want to emphasize here that ignoring the harmonics is not a good idea. And very often in load pool data, I think we even saw it today, you see these load pool for the fundamentals, but where are the harmonics at that point? And ignoring harmonics, it uses the word established habit. I would say it's a, I could use stronger words to say that it's a misleading misconception to ignore the harmonics, but it happens all the time in the practical engineering world. Another thing, before we go to real practical way of design, this is from a paper. So what happens here is, on this transistor 10 watt Cree in this paper, which is mentioned where it is somewhere there, the reference, at a fundamental impedance, which is for maximum power, the second and third harmonic angle or reactances are swept, and we have a three-dimensional graph here for maximum power and maximum efficiency. And from there, a slice here tells us the areas in which you can receive better than 80% efficiency and better than 10 watt. Now, what is interesting here for me is you can see where the optimum lines areas are, which are very narrow, very high, but right next to them are the really bad ones. And if you don't have this data, you can easily select to be somewhere there, and over temperature or some other move, you slice, you go very badly. So why am I saying all this? Yes, the simulators at the moment, being microwave office or ADS, do not provide us yet with this interesting capability, so we can define these areas and be careful where we're going and define the safe areas and know where our harmonic impedances are and our fundamentals are, so we can really do a reliable amplifier, especially when it comes to be broadband. Although this is just a single frequency, but you can combine a few frequencies and so on. And if I have to say something, what happened? Right. Another interesting thing is CDS is usually a constant number instead of being nonlinear modeled, but this paper that I was just showing the graphs from, they actually had it nonlinear modeled. And turns out that these very, if I go back, wide areas where we can design an amplifier are so wide because CDS is properly modeled, when typically the commercially available model to us do not have CDS nonlinear. And the result is, if we compare now, because they've done this comparison, that if the CDS is constant, the area that we think we should be is much more narrower than it could be to have the high efficiency and power. Again, these plotting capabilities would be nice to be added. Yes, microwave office at the moment went way ahead, I think, than ADS in all output, but this added to add a good, nice new dimension to the capabilities. And all the data is there, and I know you guys know how to do it. So given all the kind of deficiency which I just mentioned, which still exists, we don't have the way to extract this three-dimensional picture so we can understand where to be. And the CDS is not often, although it seems Amplion kind of proved me wrong. So how do we design quickly? So I'm going back now to Steve Cripps. So way before we had commercial simulators that could perform load pool with models. So Steve Cripps connected the load pool power contours with clipping the load lines on the IV curves for class A stages. And that was simple equation, simple approach, but ingenious of explaining what actually is happening before everyone else realized. Although a bit simple, the just removing the output is probably not good enough, and the outputs are usually modeled with just LC, which is not the whole picture. Steve Cripps also said at that time, I think it was not his first paper, but then the application know that the approach should be implemented in all the general simulators. It kind of never happened. Although at the time it was realized that that simple approach is also applicable. Oops, where am I? For class B and AB, because the fundamental and the harmonics, class A, class B, same thing basically. Even mathematically comes to very close to each other. So the approach of Steve Cripps was only implemented fully in this software, which is nowadays called Amplifier Design Wizard. Peter Ablich has come up with something that he calls power parameters. It's published in his book. There are some equations here. So what does this do is you use a linear model, IV curves boundaries. The whole picture is there, the feedback, although it's linear, yes. And it defines load pool contours by the Steve Cripps just at the pre-clipping power, right? The hard pre-clipping. And this is across some frequencies here, what I'm showing. So how useful or accurate is this? What happens here is there is the load pool done for a single frequency with 5 dB compression, the same transistor discussed. There is the load pull down by the Peter Ablich Steve Cripps approach. They are the top of each other. We can discuss back and forth how accurate that is, but I think it's obvious picture. So now we come to something a bit interesting, the way I saw it when I saw it. This is the linear model, and on each for maximum power load pool contours provided here, on each one of this side of the contours, there is a dot which defines at the intrinsic generator a purely resistive point, and it is where the efficiency on this contour, which is for maximum power, is maximum also. And if we remove the parasitics, this contour will come vertical, and these lines will be on the X, or on the central line here of Smith chart, purely resistive. And if we look back at the class B, class F, inverted class F, they are the dots also lining the same way as here. And now we're adding the high efficiency and the line continues. So I called it maximum efficiency line. You put this class B contour, and you know you have to sacrifice power for efficiency, and you start playing a little bit around with a very fast synthesis tool, and quickly automatically translate it back to microwave office, and you figure out where you want really to be very fast. Now with the micro office, you do it in the nonlinear model. And you can, you don't need this thing here, actually. You just do this in microwave office, and you have the maximum efficiency line. So you select points for moderate bandwidth just around them. And then you have a very practical, very quick approach to designing an amplifier that you want. Okay, well. So yeah, this was called maximum efficiency line. Now, Amplifier Design Wizard has extensive facility how to use that. It can, you can either define, right, the synthesis method is real frequency synthesis. Only real frequency synthesis will allow you multiple bandwidth match. In this case, you have fundamental, second, third harmonic, which could be quite far from each other. No other synthesis method will allow you to control all three. This one allows you multiple ways to do it. The simple one is, there's my fundamental area. Usually it's an area. You can put a dot, but you can put a circle where you want to be. The harmonic areas, you can say, I want my second harmonic to be five times less or five times bigger than the fundamental impedance. And that's all more than enough to say it's close to short, close to open. Same applies for the third harmonic. But there is all these continuous modes, which reference the papers, are also included here. So you can try the coefficients, which moves you across the band. In the middle, usually you put the max optimum behavior for class F, let's say, but then you start moving it and you have a broadband amplifier to design. It's all there. Again, the what did I do? You can see where the fundamental is for something selected and where the second and third harmonic are. One have to really go in and understand, but once you know it, it gives you very quickly to some ideas. So a design was again done. Straight from the Amplifier Design Wizard. These are the so-called contours. In this direction is the maximum efficiency line. Something was selected. As I said, there were a few iterations back and forth, just lump components, matching networks. And then finally, something was synthesized, matching network in Amplifier Design Wizard. Basically, all the parasitics taken in account during the synthesis, the discontinuities. It does this in microwave office. This is how everything was translated there. It was model. It was synthesized using, of course, the nonlinear model, harmonic balance, and axiom. But probably that wasn't necessary, but it's so fast nowadays, axiom, that it's just fun to use it. And the result compared with the previous design is slightly wider bandwidth, maybe a bit of drop of efficiency. Power was the same, just showing you the intrinsic load lines, time waveforms. Could have put the dynamic load lines, but anyway. So there we go. Just proving that this approach works. So if I have to repeat, on the previous forum, there was a discussion of behavior model or physical model, but nobody kind of discussed, what about this old approach? Just linear model and IV curves. It's still valid, still works, still gives you a very fast design method. You don't even need to do so much mold pool. What happens here is, I'm using the nonlinear model just to simulate S parameters, fit a linear model to the S parameters, and there it is. you can have to be intelligent a bit to know how to fit the model, but there is a very nice facility inside the amplifier design wizard that helps you with that. So the approach was called maximum efficiency line approach to design, moderate bandwidths. If you want wider bandwidths, you probably have to, there is an error function inside the amplifier design wizard for the matching networks, which is going to move you a bit closer to the best way to match. So you sacrifice a bit of power for the bandwidth, and efficiency also sacrifice. But all these things are there. And again, you cannot synthesize by any other means bandwidths, but the real frequency method. And Amplifier Design Wizard is the only commercial tool that can do it. Yes, in the academic level, some people develop their own real frequency synthesis, but that's academic. So the design method is fast and probably not less accurate than going only with nonlinear model and load pool simulations, or even going out and doing real load pool. And again, to say 3D plots useful, really good nonlinear models should be useful. Okay, I'm done.